Today, we are going to talk about a very, very important and an interesting topic of diabetes. Now, normally when we talk about diabetes in children, we always talk about type 1 as a primary focus. But today, what we're going to do is that we'll discuss about six cases who presented like type 1 diabetes, were managed with insulin at one point or the other. But ultimately, they had something interesting in them, as to some of them might be able to switch over to a particular oral medication. In some cases, we were able to look at more complications, other issues. So this is the importance of how we go beyond type 1 diabetes. And this is what we're going to discuss about today. We've got six interesting cases, which will be covered sequentially, covering the entire range of non-type 1 pediatric and adolescent picture in that regard. How do you classify diabetes? Onset less than 6 months, you think of neonatal, do imaging and then genetic studies. If the imaging is not clear, you want to know whether pancreas is formed or not. What is the better test, Naveen, in this setting? Which test will give you pancreatic information? So fecal elastase is the best marker, because even on CT, sometimes pancreas is not very clearly visible. Now, if the onset is after 6 months of age, whether there is a decayed presentation, yes, and the child is needing insulin, this is type 1. Don't worry. So, decay at onset, insulin requirement, don't do any workup. If you do not need insulin now, it may be honeymoon phase for some time, but maybe 1 year, 2 years, still not requiring, then you do a GAD antibody. If the antibody is positive, this is type 1. If it is negative, go for MODY. On the other hand, if there is no decay and there is no obesity, now this is a confusing picture. This can be MODY or it can be LADA, because it may evolve over time. So don't leave it, do a GAD antibody. If the antibody is positive, this is LADA. If it is negative, go for a genetic study in that perspective. And if there is obesity, no ketosis, child is stable, this is most likely a type 2 diabetes. So this is how you classify. So don't do investigations in everybody. You just classify like that. We'll take the case again. The first case, 16-year-old polyuria. What we found here was that he actually presented with decay. But the problem was that because he was obese, we thought that this could be non-type 1 diabetes and stopped. And the problem happened that he presented with decay later on. So if we just go by our algorithm that we have discussed, we say that this child has hyperglycemia, age is 1 to 18. He presented with DKA. He does not require insulin. You should have got a GAD antibody done. And that could have prevented you from developing this DKA. Second case, the same 18-year-old girl with increased urine output. And in this case, was labeled as type 1 diabetes, even though there was no DKA and was a lean individual. GAD was negative and turned out to be a MODY sort of a form. So if you look here, again, you have to look at in somebody who doesn't have a DKA and who is non-obese, the key parameter there is to look at GAD antibody. If it is negative, go for a MODY testing, which becomes important in that setting. 16-year-old boy with obesity, there is hyperglycemia. HbA1c is 8.3, ketone is 0.8. BMI 32, acanthosis present. What do you think here, Sain?
It's most likely type 2, sir, because acanthosis and all present.
So this is already obesity without DKA. So again, more than 1 year, obese, no DKA. This is most likely type 2 diabetes in that setting. Now, because the HbA1c is not very high, you can start on metformin alone in this setting. And finally, you've got this 18-year-old girl with obesity, similar picture, but HbA1c is 10, mild ketosis. So what will you do here?
Sir, is the patient having osmotic
symptoms? Ketones are present.
Sir, will require insulin initially?
So better to start insulin, maybe basal insulin rather than a proper basal bolus for type 1. So this is how the algorithm will tell you. 1 to 18 years, DKA is not there per se, but there is ketosis. Child is obese. You have to consider that maybe basal insulin will be required in this setting. So this is where you can classify. So essentially what you're looking at is three things. The age, 1 year, 1 to 18 years. Second is with regards to DKA, yes, no. Obesity, yes, no. Just three things. And most of the things come out from there. And then you have to do two things. GAD antibody and genetic study. That's it. So this is how we have put our algorithm from there.
And we had a 14-year-old girl child who was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes mellitus 1 year before in our clinic, and she was started on insulin. But since for the past 2 months, she had been having complaints of recurrent episode of hypoglycemia with very minimal insulin requirements, that is like giving on 1 unit to 2 units of Lantus, she started developing hypoglycemia. And she, due to the fact that she was having recurrent hypoglycemia, she was not taking insulin for the past 3 weeks.
So just hold on. So now you have got this 14-year-old child who was diagnosed 1 year ago and who has now presented to us with reduced insulin requirement. So why can't it just be a simple honeymoon phase, do you think?
Sir, honeymoon phase can be a possibility. But
what would be against honeymoon phase in this setting?
So honeymoon phase, not at all recovering insulin, and even seeing a small amount of insulin is causing hypoglycemia, and it is also more than 1 year.
So three points you have said, that it is now already quite some time.
Long time.
The requirement is zero, which becomes less likely. What is also very important is that this child is now presenting with hypoglycemia. Honeymoon phase is like it should have happened earlier, and then it will wean off. It's not like that your requirement was high and then you come down and then you go up. It's something like when we say that if you have somebody who had puberty and then did not progress, cannot be CDD. It's a stalled puberty. So if somebody was requiring insulin earlier and now suddenly at 1 year, your requirement is coming down, it means that this cannot be, you cannot easily call it a honeymoon phase. But of course, there can be variations, and that's what we happened with us also, that we started thinking that this could pretty much be the honeymoon phase going on. Carry on.
So when we went to the last 1 year of how the treatment went on, she had a lot of seesaw in the insulin requirement as well as in the glucose levels. At the first, when she was diagnosed with ketoacidosis, which is favoring more in term of type 1. And she started with a normal dose of 1 unit per kg. And after within 1 month of diagnosis, during the follow-up, her dose reduced to 0.2 unit per kg. So considering... Considering this as a honeymoon phase, we kept the dose to be very low at around 0.2 unit per kg. So after then, she had a stable sugars for a relatively small, quite a period of time with a dose maintaining at around 0.2 to 0.3. Then we thought this was ideally a patient presenting with ketoacidosis and also with very minimal requirements. So we considered to be a type 1 with honeymoon phase. But the problem started on with from July. So our blood sugar started getting on to be a higher trend, but sometimes it was associated with low sugars. It was high and low. So we thought that the honeymoon phase was complete. So we increased the dose from 0.3 to 0.8. So after increasing the dose to 0.8, after around 1 year, nearly around 1 year, now she started developing more of hypoglycemia, but still there were some sugars which are high in between. So
I think this is a very important table that you're showing. This child, if it was, let's say, honeymoon phase, should go down, stay stable, and then go up. You can't have that topsy-turvy curve, which is happening here, which means that there is something else going on. So this is something which we should have picked up at that time, which we probably did a bit later. But again, it tells very quickly, it can't go up and come down. So it is not honeymoon phase, if you just look by this picture. Yeah.
So that is where we started doubting the diagnosis of type 1 and honeymoon phase. And another thing that when you got HbA1c, it was very high, despite the fact that she was complaining more of hypoglycemia. So as HbA1c was very high, still we kept on insulin at a minimum dose of around 0.5.
So I think this is the big problem. Now, when you talk about algorithms, they're very easy, that, okay, our insulin requirement is low, it is Modi. In this case, it highlights how there could be variations in clinical practice. Now, when you see HbA1c of 12.5, you will doubt whether the sugars are being done properly or not, whether their meter is right or not. So a lot of this time, we just kept on doing all that. So we were not thinking of a monogenic cause, because clearly why the HbA1c is 12.5. But then, of course, once things became even more complicated, we went for it.
So after that, we kept it on a very low dose. And after 1 month, she told that, sir, they were not requiring insulin at all, because even giving a very small amount led the problem of hypoglycemia. That's where we thought of the other diagnosis. So on examining the patient, on eliciting the past history, there was nothing significant. There was no any admission in the past. And family history, we found a family history with her mother having an early onset of diabetes at around 29 years. And she also had... her grandmother having similar diabetes, but the age of onset was not known, but they said it could be around 50 to 60 years. And
now if you see so many patients who come to us, many of them have got young diabetes, 25, 30. So this relevance of three generations becomes less. But of course, in this case, this is becomes important in this regard.
And her birth history was uneventful. She was a normal newborn child. And during the postnatal period, she was not admitted for any illness and she did not have any insulin requirement during that period. So on coming to the examination, she did not have any syndromic facies or no acanthosis suggestive of insulin resistance. And she had her in the pubertal period where menarche was just started 1 month before. And anthropometry was not fitting into either type 1 or type 2. She not whether lean or nor obese. And now with all the considerations, it could be more possibly of an alternative type of diabetes, considering Modi to be one of the strong possibilities because of the fluctuation in the insulin requirement with variation in hypo and hyper, and still honeymoon phase could be a possibility. So in order to differentiate between type 1 and Modi, we decided to go with C-peptide. But within 1 year of onset, so the C-peptide should have been less than 0.4 in case if it is type 1, but we can still wait for a period of up to 2 years to completely get reduced. So even now also it was more confusing with this regard. So we just thought, what are the pros and cons and what are the things that go in for type 1 with honeymoon period and also with monogenic diabetes of end. So when we did this and we found that it was still confusing because there are a lot of things that are favoring the honeymoon phase and there are a lot of things that are going against the honeymoon phase. In this patient, we had a ketoacidosis at presentation which was highly suggestive of a type 1 diabetes, and the onset was in the 5 to 15 years of age. She presented around 13 years, and this honeymoon phase can be still very much till 2 years since the onset. But one thing that was going against was that Sarah now mentioned that there was a fluctuation where there was periods of hyper and hypo within 1 year of onset, and also at C-peptide level was normal. And considering the other form, which is more common with this age group, and considering the family history, Modi was thought of, and she had many things which went in favor, except for the fact that she had a DKA, which is very less likely, but still that was possible in some case around 5 to 10%, which is still possible. So now the two diagnoses which we had in our mind was either a Modi type or a type 1 who was in honeymoon phase.
So now if you talk about clinical decision making, it's all about odds, probabilities. So you always talk about what is your probability. So what do you think at this stage is the probability, if you give your own decision, of Modi versus type 1, what percent do you think?
So I would give of 70-30 or 80-20 towards Modi because of the fluctuation she's having and the normal C-peptide levels.
So what will be the most, now when you talk about this, then you decide about which test should be.
Yes.
And the test should be one which should be able to increase your post-test probability a lot.
Yes, sir.
So which test will be good at this stage?
Sir, in this case, since Modi is at a higher possibility, so we can directly go in for genetic panel. So that
so
we
the other option would be?
A GAD antibody. Yeah.
So if you do a GAD antibody and let's say GAD antibody is negative, it will not completely rule out
type one.
Now, when you talk about this situation where the prevalence of the disease, when you say prevalence of the disease, pretest probability of type one is less, then having a negative test, it may completely not exclude, but it will become less likely. But if you want to be 100% sure, you have to go for a genetic test. So even if your GAD is negative, you will still have to go for a genetic test. So based upon that, we decided, okay, like to directly go for a genetic test. So you need to understand why we do. If you go by our algorithm, you have somebody who had DKA, does not require insulin, we say do a GAD. But here we did not get do GAD because honeymoon phase was
almost in the time. So we got a NGS, a targeted gene panel for Modi, and she found to be positive for Modi type 5, and it was a mutation in the HNR1 beta gene, and it was pathogenic, and she was diagnosed a case of Modi 5.
What do you mean by pathogenic? When did they pathogenic, what do they mean by that?
Sir, then the definitive, there's a high 100% chance of a disease being present.
And this has been reported in a similar condition. Yes, so it may be everything is likely, but if it is not reported, they will say likely pathogenic.
Less, more likely pathogenic.
So this is clearly pathogenic. So this has been reported in a Modi case. So this is like final in that regard.
So then considering Modify, we did a ultrasonography to look for any renal anomalies, which is, as I mentioned, was more commonly seen associated with Modify. And we found that she had a PUG obstruction and hypomagnesemia, which is another common association with respect to Modify. She had a borderline low level of magnesium levels. So coming into the discussion, my small discussion regarding the HNF1 beta defect. This is basically a defect involving the HNF1 beta gene, which is basically a promoter. And it is located in the chromosome 17. And it is basically inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. But there are like number of patients who have de novo mutation, which is seen in around 50 to 60% of the patients. And previously, 10 years back, this was popularly referred to as the renal cyst and diabetes syndrome. And this HNF1 beta is basically a promoter, which is responsible for the transcription of various genes in our body, which is present in urinary and genital tract, the most common association with respect to HNF1 beta defect. And other areas, pancreas is the second most common, and involving the brain, parathyroid gland, and liver. So what are the various manifestations which we could expect in a patient with HNF1 beta defect? And what are the things we are association we should probably screen at an earlier age? The most common is the cystic and non-cystic kidney disease, which cause HNF1 beta is responsible for the nephron development up to the uppermost part of the ureter. So in this case, when we did a sonography, we found there was a pelvic dilatation, which was basically because of the HNF1 beta, which is responsible for the nephron development. So most common association with respect to kidney includes the multicystic kidney, polycystic kidney, and horseshoe kidneys, renal agenesis, renal hypoplasia, which are the most important manifestation which we need to rule out when we have a patient with HNF1 beta defect. And we also need to consider a patient of renal cyst and diabetes having together a possibility of HNF1 beta defect. Next, second common manifestation with respect to HNF1 beta is hypomagnesemia, which is basically caused as a result of HNF1 beta acts as a promoter for the FXYD gene, which is responsible for magnesium absorption in the distal convoluted tubule. So this absorption becomes defective and the patient can present as hypomagnesemia with hypocalcemia resembling Littleman syndrome. And the third common association is hyperuricemia and gout, because it is responsible for the modulation of UMOX gene, which is responsible for renal uric acid absorption, which becomes defective and the patient present with early onset gout. And also, as mentioned, with regards to our case, it could be early onset of diabetes, which could be ranging from more severe or a mild beta cell dysfunction, because HNF1 beta is a transcription factor that is responsible for pancreatic development and also regulation of various other transcription factors, which can cause in mild beta cell dysfunction and also severe diabetes. So the treatment would be variable because they may respond to minimal drugs or they may require even high dose of insulin. And other manifestation which are quite rare, including the genital tract malformation with asymptomatic liver and elevated liver enzymes. And there has been association, but it is not sure that this definitely causes renal cell carcinoma. And mental retardation and autism are rarely seen. So when should we suspect a case of HNF1 beta defect? When we have early onset diabetes along with renal cyst, when we have renal cyst after ruling out the possibility of a autosomal dominant cystic kidney disease or a multicystic kidney disease, and when these renal cysts are associated with early onset diabetes, then this would be a very high possibilities. And hyperparathyroidism and hypomagnesemia, which is not reflecting to the degree of renal insufficiency. Early onset of diabetic nephropathy, meaning that nephropathy is occurring at a very earlier onset with regard to the onset of diabetes. And as I mentioned, the management is basically with respect to management of diabetes, it depends, because in this patient which we saw, this patient was not at all requiring insulin, but there may be certain cases which may require insulin in the earlier stages, and also which may require insulin as the disease tends to be progressive in requiring insulin in the later stages. As sulfonylurea is the best management for a patient of MODY type 3, HNF1 alpha defect. In this case, the response to sulfonylurea is not well known. So this patient needs to be closely monitored for the other renal complications, and also has to be regularly monitored for magnesium levels, and also has to be monitored for uric acid gout manifestation, and also with respect to parathyroid. And she might go in for insulin, but not now, but maybe in the future. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Naveen. And so this is a very interesting case, and highlights how clinical judgment may be confusing in a lot of settings. Then you can have a lot of confusion which may happen from that perspective. But interesting that if you have a fluctuating course, and one message probably is that if your requirement is going up and down over a 1 year period, it will not be a honeymoon phase. Start thinking of something else.